preach the gospel to every creature.
Dr. Hank Lindstrom, I'm your host, and we look forward to coming into your home or wherever you might be watching the program from and taking a look at the Bible. You may want to get your Bible out. You may want to look at some of the passages we'll turn to. You might want to also maybe jot down some of the references that we'll be referring to. And we're going to take a look at this doctrine of everlasting life. Jesus promised at the moment you trust Him as Savior that He gives you the gift of everlasting life. We're going to look at one of the simplest verses in the New Testament where Christ says exactly what I just said. In John 6:47, Jesus says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath or has everlasting life." Pretty simple, straightforward. Jesus said, truthfully, truthfully, this is a truth you don't want to miss. He says, "I say unto you, he that believeth," that word means to trust. If you trust on Christ as the one who died and shed his blood at the cross of Calvary to pay for your sins, it says if you have trusted him as your only means of heaven, you have presently, present tense, everlasting life. That means right now, at this moment, at this instant, if you have trusted Christ, you have everlasting life. Let me ask you a simple question. If you've trusted Christ and you have eternal life right now at this moment, what kind of life will you have tomorrow? And the answer would be everlasting life. If you have everlasting life right now, and what kind of life would you have next week? Well, it would be everlasting. How about a year from now? Well, it would be everlasting. How about 10 years from now? It'd still be everlasting. If you have everlasting life right now, what kind of life would you have a million years from now? And the answer is it's still everlasting. You know, God used either the wrong words or he really means that from the moment you trust Christ, forever thereafter, that you possess everlasting life. I received everlasting life at age 18, and I still have it today. And I will have it 100 years from now, 1,000 years from now, 100,000 years from now, and a million years from now. Everlasting is everlasting. And if you presently possess it, which the Bible says over and over again, even in John 3:16, a verse familiar to most, it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have." Have, again, a present tense verb. It means you possess, at the moment you believe, everlasting life, and you possess it forever thereafter. Right now, if you've never trusted Christ, if you do trust him as your Savior, you could receive everlasting life and possess it for now, from now on, forever and ever and ever. It's amazing to me how many people tell me, "Well, you can lose it, and you don't know what God will do. If I commit certain sins, God may cast me out." In fact, I had one lady tell me that she had lost her salvation on several occasions. And I said, "That's impossible." She said, "Well, you don't know what sins I've committed." And I said, "Well, don't tell me, but let me share with you this wonderful verse where Jesus says that is really impossible." We're going to look at John chapter 6, verse 37. This is worth marking down. It's what I call a refrigerator verse. That's where you go over and write it on your refrigerator door, maybe on a piece of paper behind a magnet, but definitely a verse worth posting someplace. In John 6:37, Jesus says, "All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out." Notice what he says here, "him that cometh to me." If you've come to Christ and trusted him as your Savior, Jesus makes a promise, "I will in no wise cast you out." So, in other words, it doesn't matter what you have done, Christ is not going to cast you out for no reason, under no circumstances would he ever cast out somebody who has believed on him. Well, I've had a number of people that I've talked to say, "Okay, you've got me, I can't argue with the verse. He won't cast me out, but I can cast myself out, can't I?" And you know that's not even possible. Look, if you will, at verse 39, where Jesus says, this is the Father's will. You can't go any higher in authority than God the Father. And so Jesus says, this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all of which he hath given me, I should lose, please notice, it says nothing, none, but should raise it up again at the last day. So Jesus is saying that not one person would ever be lost who comes to him. In other words, you're not keeping your salvation. If you were keeping it, if I were keeping it, perhaps I would lose it. Perhaps you would lose it. But we're not keeping our salvation. He's the one that keeps us saved. And he says here, this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all of which he hath given me, I should lose the first dozen. No, it doesn't say that. It says I should lose none, but should raise them up again at the last day. So if one person in all of history were ever lost once they became saved, then Jesus would be a liar. The Bible would be wrong. And you might as well just light a match to it and walk away. But this is the promise of God. This is the will of God the Father, that of all of which he hath given me, Christ says, I should lose none, but should raise them up again at the last day. You know, if he had said he would lose one, then all of my life I'd have to wonder, maybe I'm the one he's going to lose. But I don't have to worry about that, because he said he would not lose even one. So if you've trusted Christ, my friend, you're stuck. I tell people you're stuck. You have to go to heaven whether you like it or not. Because eternal life is a gift paid for by God at the cross of Calvary, received by you at the moment you believe, and then possessed forever thereafter. And so if you possess everlasting life at the moment you believe, you'll possess it next year, 100 years from now, 1,000 years from now, 1,000,000 years from now. You'll possess it forever and ever and ever and ever. And that's got to be the best news anyone could ever hear in their life. So I would write down these verses if I were you. As I said, these are well worth marking someplace visibly in your home, maybe on your refrigerator. But John 6:37, John 6:39, Christ says, I will in no wise cast you out. And he says, I will not lose one of those that have come unto me. Let's take a look at it one more time, because it is so great to see it right in the Bible. John 6:37, he says here, all that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out, or for no reason. Then in verse 39, this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all of which he hath given me I should lose none, nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day. So once you become saved, he's not going to lose you. He's not going to cast you out. You are saved forever and ever and ever. And this is just not an isolated passage, but everywhere you look in the Bible, it says the same thing. And that is, the Bible doesn't contradict itself. There is no verse that says you can lose it. In fact, every verse that you look at, you'll find that talks about eternal life, it talks that you can't lose it. Now, what you can lose is your joy. You can lose your effectiveness. You can lose your testimony. You can lose rewards. And you can incur God's discipline upon your life. But he will never cast you out or never lose you. Once you become saved, you are saved forever. Let me share with you another wonderful verse. This is in John's Gospel, chapter 10, where Jesus says in verse 28, and again, you might want to mark the verse down, but John 10:28, Christ says, and I give unto them eternal life. Notice it doesn't say temporary life. It doesn't say probation. It says he gives you eternal life. So God doesn't give you probation, but he gives you salvation. And it is eternal, so it's forever and ever. Then it says, and they shall never, and never means never, but it says they shall never perish. And we'll see the rest of that verse on the next page. But it says that you'll never perish. In verse 28 of John 10, you'll never perish, neither shall any pluck them out of my hand. Now think about that phrase, never perish. You know, when John 3:16 says that whosoever believeth in Christ should not perish, it's talking about the penalty for sin, which is death, which ultimately means what is called the second death, the separation of your soul from God in hell forever and ever. In Revelation 20, verse 14, it says that they were cast into the everlasting lake of fire. This is the second death. So the first death is physical death, the separation of your soul from your body. But the second death is the separation of your soul from God in hell forever and ever. So when the Bible says that you will never perish, it literally means that you'll never go to hell. John 10:28. Christ says, I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. You might want to write in your margin that you'll never experience what is called the second death. You will not experience the death that occurs as a result of your rejection of Christ. John 3:16 says, whosoever believeth in Christ should not perish, but have everlasting life. But if you don't believe on Christ, you will perish, and you'll not have everlasting life. But if you believe, you'll never perish. You'll never go to hell. Isn't that great news? You can relax. You can say, wow, I have eternal life and I will never go to hell. I will never perish. Got to be good news. And then the verse goes on to say in verse 28 of John's Gospel chapter 10, neither shall any pluck them out of my hand. You'll notice the word man here is in italics. The translators added words in italics to let you know they're not in the original manuscripts. So he's really saying here, neither shall any. If, when you put the word man in there, it limits the text here because it might mean Satan could cast you out. But notice he says, neither shall any pluck them out of my hand. Whenever you're reading a verse with an italicized word, if you read it without the word and it makes good sense, just leave it out. Because sometimes the words that are added limit the sense of the verse. Christ says, neither shall any pluck them out of my hand. Once you trust Christ, you are in the hand of Jesus, and he holds you. I'll never forget one time I was crossing a dangerous intersection with my dad. I was a little boy. He grabbed my hand so tightly that it hurt. And I said, Dad, let go. Let me hold on to your hand. You're hurting me. And I'll never forget what he said. He said, no, I want to make sure you cross this intersection safely, and I will not let go until you're safely on the other side. You know, once you trust Christ, Christ will never let go of your hand until you're safely in heaven. Isn't that good news? In other words, you cannot be plucked out of his hand. He's holding your hand and will keep you in his hand until you're safely in heaven with him. Just like my dad held my hand tightly where it hurt, but yet he was protecting me lest I should let go and I could possibly be injured or killed in that intersection that we were crossing. Well, in any case, Jesus holds you in his hand, and no one is able to pluck you out of his hand. Whoever could pluck you out of his hand would have to be more powerful than Jesus. And of course, according to the Bible, Jesus Christ is God. He's God who came and took on human flesh and went to the cross of Calvary to die for you and me. Now, once you trust the Lord, the Bible says at that moment you possess everlasting life. But some people object and say, well, that means I could go out and live as I please. And the answer is no, because when you trust Christ, all of a sudden, for the first time, God becomes your father. You become his son or daughter. God is your creator and you're his creation, but he does not become your father until you trust Christ as your savior. The Bible says over in Romans chapter 9 and verse 8, those which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God. So if you're just a child born into this world in the flesh body, you are God's creation, but you don't become his child until you trust Christ as Savior and you're born again into the family of God. And from that moment on, then God becomes your father and you become his son or daughter. And from that moment on, God does not allow you to live as you please. Yes, you'll go to heaven no matter what you do, but you can incur God's discipline upon your life, and it might mean that God might even take you home to heaven early or before you had planned on it. Look at this marvelous verse over in Hebrews chapter 12 in verse 6. Hebrews 12, that is, if you will, verse 6, where it says, "For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth." Now that word in modern English would read disciplines. So he disciplines and scourges, which is a little more violent, every son whom he receives. So when you trust Christ as Savior, you become a son in God's family by the new birth. And it says, for whom the Lord loves, he disciplines or chastens and scourges every son whom he receives. Verse 8 is a most amazing verse. It says, if you be without chastisement, or if you be without God's discipline, whereof all are partakers, every person that is received into God's family by the new birth, by trusting Christ, are partakers of God's discipline. And it says, if you be without that discipline or chastisement whereof all are partakers, it says you're a bastard. Pretty strong word in the King James. It says you're a bastard and not a son. In other words, you're illegitimately claiming to be a Christian when you indeed are not. And so if you trust Christ, you cannot live as you please because God is going to discipline you. And in some cases, that might mean he would take you home to heaven sooner than you had planned on going. So certainly the Bible doesn't give us a license to live as we please. We're saved no matter what we do. But if you are going to live in rebellion against the Lord might decide to take you home to heaven sooner than you had planned to go. When I was a little boy raised at home, I can remember my dad standing at the front door when I would misbehave on occasion. And I never remember him saying, "Son, we're bolting the door shut, and we never want to see your face again. Get lost. We're kicking you out forever." Well, that never happened. And God won't do that either. But I can remember my dad standing at the door and saying, "Son, get into the house, and get into the house right now." And my dad would discipline me. Well, the same thing is true when you trust Christ as Savior. Christ will never cast you out or lose you, but he will discipline you. He's never going to say, "Get lost, we never want to see you again." He might say, "Come on home to heaven now," and you might go to heaven sooner than you'd planned on going. And the Bible gives lots and lots of examples. 1 Corinthians 11:30, because the Corinthian believers were living rebellious lives against the Lord, it says, "For this cause many of you are weak, and many of you are sickly, and many of you are dead." God had taken a lot of the Corinthian believers home early because of their sin. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 8, talks about 23,000 that God took home in just one day. So God can take believers out early if they are not going to listen to him. But once you become saved, you are saved eternally, and you can be absolutely assured of that, that he'll never kick you out, and that he will never lose you. You know, right where you are, if you've never trusted Christ, you could receive this wonderful gift of everlasting life. All you have to do is maybe whisper a prayer between you and the living God. If you don't know what to pray or what to say, you could say something like, "God, I'm a sinner. I don't understand much about the Bible, but I believe Jesus Christ died and paid for my sin, was buried and rose again from the dead. I trust Jesus Christ right now as my only hope of heaven, as my only means of entrance into heaven." And the moment you trust Christ, God up in heaven knows and he saves you. And then, if you live for him, God will bless you and reward you. But if you are delinquent and rebel against him, then he will discipline you, but he'll never kick you out. He'll never leave you or forsake you. He will chasten or discipline you, and with the intent that he could get you back on track so that you could live a life that God would bless or reward here on this earth. And that, of course, is really great news. Let me tell you about some of the resources we have here at Bible Line. One of them is a book on evangelism that tells you how to tell someone else. The best book in the world I've ever seen that tells you how to open your mouth, what to say when your mouth is open, how to close your mouth and actually lead that person to Christ. And it imagines a conversation. What you'll say, what they'll say, what you'll say, what they'll say. And it goes through some of the basic doctrines. So if you are having some confusion about some of the basic issues about being saved forever and then earning rewards after you become saved by serving the Lord? This book will clarify all of that for you and be an excellent tool. It's called Handbook of Personal Evangelism, a wonderful gift to somebody else who's a Christian who maybe would like to learn how to witness. This book tells you how. And, most of all, though, we care about you and we care about whether you would make heaven or not. Because a lot of people, I believe, might even claim that they are Christian, but are uncertain as to whether they're going to spend eternity in heaven or not. And that's because they've never, perhaps, heard a clear presentation. And like I like to tell people, that once you trust Christ, you possess from that moment on everlasting life. It's a gift. It's paid for. All you do is receive it. And from that moment on, you are eternally saved. Christ says, I will in no wise cast you out. John 6:37. He says, I will not lose you. John 6:39. In John 10:28, he says, I give them eternal life. He says, they will never go to hell. They'll never perish. And thirdly, he says, neither shall any pluck them out of my hand. So once you trust the Lord as your Savior, you are saved and saved forever and saved eternally. And then you can concentrate on serving God, which will bring about rewards and blessings in your life here, and also rewards that you will receive in heaven forever and ever. You know, Christ said, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. The way we do that is by living for Christ here, and we'll earn rewards that will be given out there in heaven. And if you're a believer, you ought to really begin to do that, because otherwise, when you enter heaven, I believe you'll be ashamed, and I believe you'll suffer loss of reward. You'll still be saved, but you'll be embarrassed. You'll be regretful. I believe you'll maybe even shed some tears as you're going to stand before the Lord ashamed because you did nothing since you were saved. But if you live for Christ, God will reward you and bless you. And that book on evangelism that we just talked about has a whole chapter on God's discipline and rewards that occur for the believer. So you might want to call in and order that, because it's a powerful, powerful tool for you, not only to understand your own salvation and where works come after salvation for reward, but how to explain that to the lost person you're witnessing to, because most people think they have to work their way to heaven, when the Bible says salvation is not of works, it's the gift of God, it's been paid for already, and we just simply receive it at the moment we trust Christ as our Savior. I'm going to share with you another wonderful verse that impacted me very greatly, and that is over in the book of Ephesians in chapter 2, where the Bible says that we're saved by grace apart from works. It says here in Ephesians 2, for by grace are you saved, and that means saved from hell to go to heaven, through faith, and of course it's faith in Christ Jesus. And this salvation is not of yourself, it is the gift of God, and it's not of works, lest any man should boast or brag. So salvation is not of works. It's not of works. It's not of yourself. It's the gift of God. It's by grace or by mercy that you're saved through faith in what Christ did. So if you trust Christ as your only means of heaven, the Bible says that you're saved. And really the tense here should read, for by grace you have been saved through faith. And every believer, at the moment they believe or trust Christ, becomes saved. And they can always look back to that event as a past event, because it is something that happens at the moment you trust Christ. If you've never done that, could I encourage you right now to trust Christ and receive that gift of eternal life? Just tell the Lord, Lord, I'm a sinner, but I believe Jesus Christ died and paid my sin debt in full by his death and shed blood. I believe that Christ was buried and that he rose again from the dead. I trust him right now to save me, to give me the gift of everlasting life. And Christ will never cast you out. He'll never lose you. You become saved at that moment forever. But rewards can be lost. So we need to begin to live for Christ and earn rewards.
Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature.